Hello, you wonderful people, and welcome to another episode of Super Fantify. This being a show where I talk about shows of the supernatural, fantasy, and or science fiction genre. For today's episode, I'm going to talk about the series finale of Bitten, as well as the latest episode of 12 Monkeys. In the series finale of Bitten, we have, Jeremy and Nick have been locked up by Constantine. Constantine basically has this plan, I can't believe the asshole turned on him. I was like, last episode, I was like, okay, at least he's being somewhat trustworthy, and bam, there you go. At the very end, you turn on him. Essentially, the plan was to kill Jeremy, and at the beginning, once Jeremy's dealt with, essentially, he'll go around taking care of all the other packs. Essentially, the other packs will follow underneath him, or, they get dealt with because he's like, I have the numbers to fight the other packs. Because essentially he wants to get rid of all packs and have them all serve under him, under one pack. He'll be the ruler of all, he'll be the alpha to all wolves. And Jeremy's kind of like, that's stupid. Essentially that you're not fit for it. And Constantine suggests doing a certain tradition in Russia. It's a Russian tradition to hunt, that the new alpha hunts the previous alpha, so meaning they're going to be hunting Jeremy. And all this while, Elena, Clay, Alexei, and Sasha are all kind of planning everything. It's like, okay, like, what do we do? We're going to get Jeremy back, but how are we going to go up against Constantine and his large numbers? And Elena, because she still hasn't let it slip, is that, well, she ends up explaining it to Sasha, which I'm surprised she didn't go to Clay about it, but granted, I guess it kind of makes sense why she never told Clay. But it's like, she's actually like, okay, like, what do I do about this? Because she told Sasha about the premonition and she's so scared about it. She's like, basically, I'm going to destroy everything. Essentially burn it all down to the ground. And sadly, we can only assume, because of the way things are, those two, Marsden as well as that other werewolf from last episode before last, both of them got killed by the Russian wolves. I think his name is Kane. He ended up escaping because we do see him at the end of the episode, but the other two most likely die. But they do make it seem like, the way they make it sound, there were a whole bunch of other wolves that got killed too. They just saw those specific three, but Constantine was like, yeah, we wiped out most of your pack. So it must mean like the other wolves in Jeremy's pack were dealt with too. Because essentially, if they didn't serve on the Constantine, they died. But every one of them was like, Elena Michaels is my alpha, and I won't serve Constantine. And that ended up coming back to Constantine. He's like, you're not even an alpha. Elena is. Essentially, he's going to, like, essentially use Nick as a messenger to be like, Elena comes and comes to be hunted by them, or they outright kill Jeremy. No, they'll hunt Jeremy instead, but they'll still come and track you down anyway, and you'll be dealt with. But we ended up seeing, what ended up happening was the albino showed up. The albino, I really like the fact is that the albino kind of called Constantine out, because it's like, you only bare your fangs at like the most convenient time, rather than as a proud werewolf, you're just like, you're not always baring your fangs, you just kind of work behind the scenes. Your dad wasn't even fully dead yet before you took, your dad wasn't even dead yet before you sat yourself down in his throne. And because the albino was basically like, I take my anger out on Jeremy, or I take it out on you. I did like the fact is that Jeremy did escape the he did escape the cell. I was like, oh, Jeremy's, oh, he's scot-free. And it, nope, the albino shows up. And then, Clay and Alexei helped deal with the albino when he was going to take Jeremy out into the woods. He had that claw attached and stuff. And it's just like, wait, part of me was wondering, like, why did you do that? I guess he wanted to make it extremely painful. Because the fact is, we've never actually seen those guys actually turn into wolves, him nor his brother. That's kind of interesting. I was expecting to have seen that, but no, that's not the case. When you actually think about it, when you actually break that down, it's kind of interesting. In a series finale about a show about werewolves, literally saw one werewolf transformation. Something, I don't know, I didn't even think about that to just now. We've only saw, I don't know, I guess in my mind I was thinking everyone was going to shift. I thought, you know, because we brought up the fact that Elena can't shift because it'll basically destroy her uterus and she'd bleed out. And it's like, I was still expecting her to kind of like transform to fight somebody. But it's like, no, the only person that transformed this episode was Sasha. And I did like the fact is that that was part of the plan to out them. And like the moment Sasha was there, and I was just like, wait, what are you doing? And there's all those people. I was like, that's the plan, to out werewolves. And he changed in front of everybody. And so it's like, people were freaked out, but they kept a little calm. I was like, once I saw that officer with the gun, I was like, yeah, he's going to be the one to shoot Sasha. But the mayor is kind of slowly closing in. He's about to touch him. But he's growling a little bit, and the officer flips out and shoots him. And he's holding. It was actually simple. It was kind of sad, you know. The mayor's holding Sasha, and he's just like, "No, it's okay. We're gonna get you help." And then Paige says, "She's like, it's gonna be okay. They'll know. They'll know what you did for them." And it's just like, oh, it's just because Sasha made the sacrifice because he didn't want Elena to do it because she was gonna be the one to do it. But I knew it was going to go that way because Sasha himself knew that there was a good chance he wasn't going to come out of this alive. And it's sad. But, you know, now the entire world ends up knowing about werewolves. He had to do one last thing, you know, because, you know, I guess in Sasha's mind, he was never able to do anything to protect anyone. His wife died. Elena's mom died. Alexei and Katya's mom died, plus Katya's dead. He wanted to do something for Alexei and Elena. And I guess this was his one way of protecting them. And then we had, even though I really like that we did have a final showdown with the albino. Granted, I was expecting Clay to be the one to kill him, but it's kind of like, well, Clay did kill the other albino, so it's kind of okay. Man, those suckers can fight. It's like Clay has never actually won a fight against either one of them. Didn't do it against the other one. Didn't get to get this one. The reason why he got the other one is because he turned into a wolf and got him. But it's like hand-to-hand combat. He didn't win. And he was there choking him out. Which, beforehand, dude, like, the albino stabbed Jeremy's eye. I was like, ah! The moment he got stabbed, I started screaming myself. It made me cringe. So I was like, oh my no, Jeremy! I was like, okay, he's not dead. He just got his eye stabbed out. But still, that sucks. But Alexei was the one that, which, you know, to me, that was, I guess, poetic, I guess. The fact is that it was Alexei that finished him. He took that spike that the ropes were being held by and threw it right in the center of his head and killed him. It's like, it needed to be Alexei, you know, to get revenge for the fact that he killed their mom as well as Katya, so, you know, kind of revenge and everything. But, you know, because they exposed him, Elena was like, yeah, you could try and kill me, but it won't be like, oh, as a wolf, you'll be protecting me. It's like, no, people will know now that werewolves exist, so if you kill me, you'll be in a prison, you'll go to prison like a normal human. And then she's like, I forgot what it was that she threatened him with. What was it like that if anything happens to her, they'll immediately find out it was him or something like that? It was just kind of interesting because Elaine, because I thought it was kind of a badass. She was a badass because she could have snuck in and, you know, went after Sasha alone, which granted, I'm sure the mansion was like covered head to toe with all the Russian wolves. But it's like, no, she, like a badass that she is, she came through the front door guided by his men. It's like, oh, you were looking for me? And then she did what the vision told. Granted, she was not nearly as bloody. I mean, like I said, it was more of a metaphor. Granted, maybe that's because they changed it. Maybe their original idea for it, you know, because this was like I said, I get the feeling like this wasn't necessarily their idea to kind of end it this soon. But I feel like they kind of had to change what they originally had planned. Because she was not nearly covered in as much blood. But, you know, I figured as much that the whole thing was kind of a metaphor and not literal. It was half metaphor and half literal because metaphorically she did burn it all down because she revealed the revealed all werewolves to like the human world, because essentially she didn't want things to keep going the way they were going, that, you know, they were doing what they needed to do. Like, the fact is that they killed people to hide their secret. You know, if regular people found out about what they were, they had to kill them. And she was tired of that. And she was tired of the world that they were living in, because, like, the wolves felt like, you know, because they had anonymity, because the human world didn't know about them, they could go around doing all this killing and doing, you know, Constantine could do what he was doing, killing people who didn't serve him. It's just like, no, there's no more of that now that the world knows about us. But she did literally burn it down. She got, I think, essentially it was all the history of the wolves. I don't know if it's all history, like, across all werewolves, or was it just specifically there, you know, specifically connected to North America. Granted, the news went worldwide, but it's like she literally burnt the mansion down, too. So that's why I said it was, like, half literal, half metaphorical. But it's kind of interesting, because you hear Jeremy's driving in a car, and he hears the message from essentially a news broadcast talking about the fact is, you know, what's happening with werewolves. Even Elena admitted there will be people who fear them, but not everyone. You know, it's just, this is the way things has to be done. And, you know, Constantine ended up going back to Russia. I did almost skip over. I can't believe it. That apparently that whole Rachel and Nick thing apparently was a thing. I was thinking that was a thing, but the way Nick shot it down, I was like, no, you're, I was like, yeah, Paige, you're reading too much into it. No, apparently that is a thing, because she's like, we have to deal with the, you know, after this is all done, then we can talk about whatever it is between us. I was like, so there is a thing between you. Didn't realize that. Didn't come across my mind. I did like the fact is that putting all those pouring the bleach in the baby bottles. At the beginning, like, when Nick was kind of, like, joking about it being a weapon, I was like, Nick, you're stupid. She's just cleaning out the bottles. It's like, no, they are weapons. Oh, well, I feel stupid. I don't know why. Just in my mind, it's like, I thought that was kind of it was going to be kind of a joke. It's like, we're going to use these as a weapon. It's like, no, she's taking this time to clean out Roscoe's bottles. It's like, no, that's not the case. Oh, okay. I did like the fact is, you know, she ended up, you know, showing Nick that she kind of defended herself. She can defend herself. She shattered that pot. I like the fact is that she killed one of the two Russian wolves that came. She ended up breaking his neck. Granted, now, I thought she was going to do a 180, like, turn his head all the way around and break it like that. But still, pretty badass that she did what she did. Even Nick, after, like, seeing that dude fall dead, Nick was kind of like, holy crap. But at the end, it does seem like they kind of get together. Afterwards, we kind of see Roscoe a little bit older. So I can only assume, that they did eventually get together. Elena and Clay are off living, you know, together. Jeremy revealed to everyone, well, he anonymously told everyone where Karen was. He actually lived, because the sad thing about it is he actually liked Karen. I wish she hadn't remembered what she remembered. You know, kind of, I bet you, it kind of probably hits Jeremy harder than anyone, because it's like, if things had happened now, then he wouldn't have had to kill her. Like, if, like, this whole plan Elena had, you know, probably more so than anything, he blames himself, because he's like, he didn't have to kill her. It's just, you know, because of that tradition, he killed her. So it's like, you know, because he never really, he kind of, even to the very end, kind of hit it. But it's obvious he had strong feelings for her, because he really liked her. But I don't know, man. It's kind of sad. And you see Elena and Clay kind of going back. Did that house that they were posted up at, the one where they met with the albino? The one he had set the traps in. Is that why he picked that specific house? Because he knew it was something they were interested in? Or was that a completely different house? Do let me know. Or am I just being stupid? I'm pretty sure that was a different house. I mean, the same house. I'm pretty sure that was the same house, but maybe it was a different house. Maybe that's why he chose it, because he knew they picked it or whatever. To me, it'd be a little hard to kind of get, I don't know. I mean, maybe you could look over the fact is that the albino was trying to kill you in that house. I mean, well, he set a trap there. Because the whole point wasn't necessarily to kill them, because the whole point was to kind of get himself arrested, to kind of put them in a compromised position, whatever the case may be. And we also see Kane and Alexi. It's like, okay, so what do y'all do now, you know, that you're not working for a pack? It's like, you know, what did they do? To me, I was wondering, because we saw Alexi kind of leave with Jeremy, like, you know, after Elena burned down the house. So it's kind of like, okay, I'm guessing he's going to follow Jeremy around a while. It does make you wonder what was in that note that Alexei had, that Sasha had left for Alexei. It does make you, essentially you're saying, like, it's a note to tell him why I'm doing what I'm doing, so. I do hope in some, you know, shape or form, Alexei was proud of his dad for doing what he did. I'm sure he's pissed at him on some level, too, because he's like, because Alexei initially thought his dad ran away. Clay was kind of smart. He's like, no, he, the way you were defending Sasha like that so quickly, like, it's like, no, you know what he's doing, don't you? She's like, you trust me, right? He's like, yeah. So, Alexei probably is pissed at him for not telling him what he was about to do, but, you know, probably still proud of him, too, because he died, you know, like I said, protecting them. So, it does make you wonder, I am sad that this is a series finale. It's still a nice series finale. I am curious, like, what the world is like now that they know, like, werewolves are, you know, exist. It makes me wonder, like, was that kind of the plan anyway? Were they going to, like, because I haven't looked into it, so I'm curious, was this the original plan to, like, did they go into this season know it'd be the final one? Or was that just something they were just like, yeah, sci-fi's not picking us up for another season. Let's rewrite this ending of this season and make it a series finale. Because it does make you wonder, like, what the world is like now that werewolves are out. Because I would have been curious to see, like, oh, what if this was actually a season finale and then, like, next season you get to see what the world's like now that everyone knows that they exist. Because, like I said, there's, like, so many... I haven't read the books, but like I said, I've seen like a list of some of the supernatural creatures in this. Like, I forgot, I think it was this series that's, like... I'm pretty sure I could be 100% wrong that, like, vampires exist in this universe as well as, like, necromancers. There's, like, a whole bunch of, like, other creatures in this universe besides werewolves and witches. Granted, werewolves have always been the biggest focus of it. And maybe that was kind of the whole plan. It was never to, like, really focus on any other creatures, just them. Because, you know, the witches are still in hiding, though. You know, the interesting thing, though, is that came of this season, though, I'll admit... Savannah never showed up again. I was so curious that would, you know, she'd pop up again because, you know, her and Elena, you know, ended up kind of bonding together. You know, for the last night, I cannot remember her name to save my life because I was thinking, like, yeah, I was so hoping that Elena get to see, oh, what was that witch's name again? It just popped in my head. It was like, Savannah. I don't know why that popped in my head now of all times, but hey, lucky for me, it did because I didn't spend like 5 minutes going, and then having to cut it out, you know, so... But overall, it's a very nice series finale. I'm really sad to see it end because I wanted to see more. I really did want to see, like, more supernatural creatures in this universe. But still, I'm glad it ended the way it did. Like I said, I was surprised that, you know, I took the whole vision premonition as a metaphor. You know, even Paige kind of told it was a metaphor, but it ended up being halfway literal. But, yeah, I would be curious to see, like, you know, just like a little bit of a aftermath, you know, a little bit of an epilogue to show, like, where everyone's at, what they're doing. It, you know, we get a little taste of what the world is like, you know, now that everyone knows werewolves exist. There are sanctuaries being built. Like, what was it? They're being protected. It's like, there's like a X amount of number of werewolves are being protected. So it's like a sanctuary for werewolves, or is it just kind of like, they're kind of put on a endangered species list or something like that. They're treated differently. Because it's interesting because it's like, I kind of brought this up, was it last episode or the episode before last? The fact is, Elena brought up the fact is that they are human. You know, because the series is always focused on the fact is that they're werewolves. They're wolves, never focusing on the fact is that they're humans. I guess that was always the pack mentality to think of themselves as way different from humans. It's like, they're not that different. Yes, you turn into wolves, but it's like, you still are human too, so. I'll admit, it's not the most action-packed finale, but still, it was nice. And like, once again, sad to see it end, but at least they wrote it in a way of having a proper ending. And who knows, maybe later on down the road, you know, they talked about it with Haven, at least the creators of Haven, then maybe the creators of Bitten might get a chance to be brought back for us, you know, maybe something small or maybe something big. Maybe we'll get introduced to a new series. Maybe this is the end of the story for these particular characters, but maybe we'll get another show that set place in a Bitten universe where we get to look at those other supernatural creatures. Maybe. I mean, I'd like to hope. I'd like to think and hope that that might be a possibility. So you never know. Now moving on to this week's episode of 12 Monkeys, which Surprisingly enough, we kind of deal with it immediately. The virus is immediately destroyed and dealt with. Which I was kind of surprised, because we did have Cole like talking to Jennifer, because Cassie's still like, no, we should kill. She's got a gun pointed towards Cole. She's got a gun pointed towards Ramsey, because she's like, okay, yeah, he tried to release the virus, but Cole is like, no, Ramsey's on our side now. Like, he, you know, it's okay. And because she's like, move Cole so I can kill Jennifer. And essentially, he talked her down, like, just give me the virus, you know. You don't have to do this. You don't want to hurt all these people. I know you don't. End up getting the virus. End up tracking down all the viruses. And they end up burning it, getting rid of it. And I love it. In that instant moment, all three of them start having headaches. And then their nose start bleeding. I was like, oh, is this him getting erased from time? It's like, I didn't know getting erased from time actually hurts. I thought it was just kind of a pop, you're done. You just fade away. It's like, oh, it hurts. It's like, oh no, they're not being erased. It's just time is changing. And that's the effect of it. And the reason why it's hurting them is because, Jones explains it later as a fact, it's because prevent them. They are the only ones that remember the fact is the alternate timeline. The previous timeline, they remember it, no one else does. And I did like it though, just everyone's bleeding. Apparently the virus has been pushed back a year. And that's not the only change. One of the scientists, I forgot his name, it was brought up in this episode, but he's the scientist who died last season when they raided Spearhead trying to get their core so they could get the machine to work again. And he died during that, but he's sitting right there, and Jones is telling him this, and he's like, I died? She's like, yes, multiple gunshots. And he's like, yeah, I prefer this timeline. She's like, I prefer it too. Because she explained that to everyone, and everyone's mind is blown. They're like, wow, there's another timeline we don't remember. That's crazy. And then we end up finding that doctor. I don't know this actor's name. I know him as Gerard from... Gerard Argent from Teen Wolf, but he apparently is Joan's lover. Granted, this alternate timeline, she has a boyfriend, and it was kind of quite sad because it's like she doesn't know him at all, and even she was kind of surprised. It's like, did you have something to say? It's like, I guess you don't remember me at all. It's like, I guess it's gonna make it awkward when you come to my bed tonight. And then Jones was kind of like, whoa, she got a dumbfounded look on her face, because the fact is she's never had anyone, you know, like the last person who she was probably with was her husband that she was with for 6 days. I did think that was sweet. I did like it when everything was changing. You saw it just like the world is kind of fast forwarding around her. And because of that, like you see her kind of moving around and you kind of see the shadows of like the alternate future kind of setting in, because she ends up bumping into someone that like faded person kind of like turns towards her but keeps walking. So it's like time trying to readjust itself to the new things around her, because time is changing around them without affecting them. I mean, other than the nosebleed. So that's kind of interesting. That's obviously like a key sign to show us, like that shows us that time is changing. Anytime one of those four, their nose bleeds or they get a headache and their nose bleeds, that means time has changed. I did really like that. And it was really sad because the first thing she did was she went to go to Hannah's blanket, and she's holding it tight. And, you know, the name is fading a little bit, but then it sets in, and then just, you know, see her kind of get a little sad, because that means her little girl still dies, you know, even with things changing. But like I said, the virus is supposed to get released like 2016. It spreads, killing a lot of people 2017, but it seems like it gets pushed back even further. Even Cassie dies much later on in the timeline. I really like that. The fact is that Cassie's like, okay, now that everything, the virus has been dealt with, but we're still here, so obviously there's something wrong. All right, let's go back to the future. First, kill Jennifer. Let's kill Jennifer and Ramsey. And Cole's like, whoa, we can't do that. She's like, you've become soft. You forgot the mission that we're supposed to accomplish. She stabs Ramsey and sends him to the future and goes back with him. And essentially, they torture Ramsey to get information, specifically Deacon does. And that is hands down like when he's trying to waterboard and kind of drown him to get information. Hands down one of my favorite scenes because of what Ramsey said. It's like Ramsey being a badass. Essentially, it's like, you know what? I went back in 2013, I came across someone. Essentially, he was telling Deacon's backstory. We ended up finding out that Deacon came from an abusive family because his dad abused his mom and was beating her. And essentially, Ramsey was like, you should thank me. I'm the one who called the cops. Because if it wasn't for him calling the cops, Deacon's dad was going to, he would have killed his mom. And he was talking about the fact is how Deacon was crying the entire time. He's like, are you going to cry, Deacon? I love the fact is, I forgot what Deacon's full name is, but he even called Deacon by his full name. And you could tell it's getting Deacon and stuff. And I just love it. After he tells the whole story, he's like, you know what, Deacon? All that talking, it's made me a little thirsty. And just Deacon was like, and trying to drown. And just like, wow, I love that Ramsey just got underneath his skin like that. Cassie came in to try and pull Deacon off of him. And just like, I just like, that was so badass of Ramsey. Because it's like, obviously, you're back in time. You're going to look up your enemies. Of course you're going to find out, look up your enemies and see, you know, where they came from. Because he wanted to know how Deacon became the man he did. And it's like, I kind of see now, you know, maybe somewhere in his mind he's thinking like, oh, you kind of become like your father. You kind of got that from your father. And it's just like, you almost see Deacon just kind of like, just panicking. He's like, he just got underneath my skin. Cassie's like, don't let him get underneath your skin. He's like, well, it's too bad. He did. He's just trying to get to you. It's like, well, he got to me. And I love that though. The fact is Cassie is like, cares about Deacon. Even Cole kind of brings up the fact is like, oh yeah, yeah, everyone's cool with Deacon. That's, okay, that's that, I guess. It's so crazy because she's, like, you know, over the course of the 8 months, we saw that at the beginning, like, Cassie, in the time she was there in the future, she changed. She hurt a lot of people. She did a lot of things that the old Cassie wouldn't have done. And it gets reflected in this episode. It's just crazy to me how different they are. Cole became more like Cassie. Cassie became more like Cole. It's just like, oh my God, that I love that twist like that. Not only is she in his future and he's in her present, not only are they in two different timelines, they switched, you know, being the characters that they are. And the fact that she actually cares for Deacon, he's kind of like a partner to her, because she even quoted Deacon, you know, he's always saying like, you can't let someone live, because if you let them live, you create an enemy. Let them live today, create an enemy tomorrow. And she actually quoted that to like Cole at the beginning when she was like, yeah, you have to kill Ramsey and Jennifer. And even Cole looked at her like, what? And Ramsey's like, Deacon. It's like, holy crap. She even quotes what he says too. It's like, how tight did they get in that time frame? And you even had that moment, that twisted moment where she brought Ramsey's son in, which granted, when you break it down, it's kind of like, he's like, is that you? It's like, the fact is, he hasn't seen his son in 30 years. No, it's like more, to be exact, it's like 28 or 29. But that's a long time. Because even after a while, he's like, it's been so long. Like, when he was working with the 12 Monkeys, it's like, it's been so long, I don't even remember my son's face. So it's like, this is his first time seeing him in over 28, 30, 29 years. I mean, for his son, it's probably been a couple months. But for him, it's been even longer. And in fact, it's Cassie brought him in there. And it's just like, holy crap. How low have you stooped, Cassie, that you're willing to try and use a kid to, you know, get some information out of, like, Ramsey? Because Ramsey keeps telling him, I literally don't know anything about, you know, the, what were they called? I forgot what they were called. The blue guys that showed up last episode, the ones that traveled through time. Essentially, they want information on them. But it's like, Ramsey has no idea. He helped them with the virus, and that's it. I did like it at the beginning of the episode when they were like destroying the virus, about to destroy the virus. Cassie's like, help us. Aren't what you're doing just standing there? Help us. He's like, I'm not going to get in your way, but I'm not going to help you either. You know what this means. This means my son will disappear. It's just, you know, like I said, you kind of understand why Ramsey's doing what he does, because if he changes the future, there's no guarantee that things will line up, that he'll end up having a son. His son will vanish from existence. If he has to vanish for the world to be a better place, that's fine, but he's not going to do that, you know, to his son. So, like I said, I love the fact is that that's not going away. He's not going to interfere, but he's not necessarily going to help them per se. But, I did also like in this episode, the fact is we have Jennifer and Cole kind of buddying up. And it's like, Jennifer has some kind of connection to all this, like a special connection, because she has some like thing in time. Like apparently she can see time. She's like, I am time. It's stuff Olivia told her. And it's like, what is Jennifer? Because it does seem like she knows stuff that she shouldn't know. She knows about them being time travelers, even though Cole's never outright told them that. It's like, you know, you should get back to your own time. And then, like, he's kind of like, how do you know all this? And we have Jennifer saying the number 607, and he looks at the paper, and it's like, that's Joan's number. And I love the fact that he calls Joan's asking for her for help. And he's like, why are you calling me? You told me we should not have any contact. You know, we'll affect the timeline and everything. He's like, but you left me here. So he's like, just remember to leave a note for yourself to come get me here in 2016. She's like, the fact is that you told me I'm right here. I'll take a mental note. Okay. He's like, are you still here? He's like, but I'm still here. She's like, exactly. Meaning I'm still pissed at you or whatever, so I'm not coming to get you. Either I'm unable to come get you or I'm choosing not to. And hangs up. It's like, okay. And it looked like she was only wearing a shirt, so it's like, what was Jones doing? But maybe she was actually hooking up with the boyfriend that she has in the future. It makes you wonder, at what point in time did they meet? Was that something like, because by changing time, there was a lot more people that survived the virus. So maybe they met way into the past and, you know, just in this timeline, they're together because he survived. Or maybe that's a more newer relationship. I feel like, nah, it's probably, I get the feeling like it's an old relationship. Like, they've actually been dating for a while, which makes that even more gut-wrenching. It's even sad because at the end, he's packing up all his stuff. Because I love it. The moment she comes in the room, she sees him there, and she does, like, an about-face. And he's like, no, I'm about to leave. He's like, you know, one of my favorite parts was basically tearing down the walls that you put up around yourself. He's like, now I get to do that all over again. It's kind of like a situation. It's one of those romantic things where it's like, you know, you've forgotten about me, but that just means I get to make you fall in love with me all over again. So it's kind of like, it's sweet in a way. You can see that she is a little sad. It's kind of like he knows about you, but you know absolutely nothing about him. But we did have Jennifer. It came up a very interesting thing because Jennifer, her sole purpose, she's been told her sole purpose was to do this, to kill all these people. Because basically, Olivia told her, like, if she kills all these people, all the voices in her head would disappear. And Cole's like, no, the voices won't disappear. She's just like, I have one purpose in life, and you kind of took that away from me, so what is there for me now? And it seems like, and it kind of gets brought up in this episode, I did kind of wonder about that in season one, because it seemed like she kind of did. Jennifer has a thing for Cole, but she's a little upset because she's like, obviously it's you and Cassie, you have feelings for her. It's like, she will never love you, and she even kisses him and everything. There's even one point where she's cut her arm, and he's like, why'd you do that? She's like, I always have to do bad things for you to get your attention. It's just like, it's a little hard because it's like, oh, because she likes you that much that she just wants your attention. She cares for you so much. I mean, what made her act like that is because she saw the picture of Cole and Cassie, you know, from the 40s. And it's a little heartbreaking. But then, you know, Cole sits there and he's like, you can do whatever you want. You know, you have your life now. You don't have to do this. You know, to do it, just leave this all behind. Go out there, search. There's a whole world out there. Go find your purpose. Find what's, you know, fits you. And apparently we end up finding out that what fits her is her and the daughters. Because we already knew that was in the future, but I thought that would have changed because of that. Because, you know, because that did make me wonder, because the fact is Jennifer was already alive in the future. And so, you know, she ended up leaving. And a very interesting thing, like, you know, she, her daughters captured Jones and brought her to them. I expected her to meet with Jennifer personally, but no, she didn't. It was one of her daughters that was like, yeah, where's James Cole? She's like, James Cole isn't here. Why not? It's like, we're no longer working together because he's not, you know, in the mission like he should be. But he's like, no, you should bring James Cole back. You have to, because our mother wishes it. Because she's like, one act of mercy. The fact is that he showed, like, he saved her. He didn't kill her. Plus, he told her to get away. He's like, that one act of mercy, they were basically indebted to it. So, basically, Jennifer, in the future, was like, bring Cole back to his time. You know, it was her way of paying a debt for the fact is that he saved her life. He spared her life. And they ended up bringing Cole back. And I love the fact that Jones is like, okay, Cole, are you with me on this? And he's like, yeah. And it's like, yeah, next time you send us, it's the 40s. Because it's like, that's the furthest they've ever gone back. So that's pretty neat. Granted, they did fix the machine because, you know, Cassie did end up gathering parts. That's kind of what they were doing at the beginning. We see kind of her and Deacon kind of teaming up. It's like that's what they were doing, gathering parts to repair the machine after they kind of had to make it explode to get rid of those blue people. But, you know, the thing is, Jones is like, are you still on my side? And he's like, yeah, I am. But it's like, Cole isn't the same person he was at the beginning of this. Very different. He kind of brings it up to Cassie, too. He's like, she's like, we have a mission. Think about that. You're up here. She's essentially like, if we're going to work together, you have to put the mission first. But then Cole's like, I went back in time. I killed a guy. You know, that was, you know, my mission. I was told, like, I go back, I kill this guy. It's all done. I killed him. Nothing changed. And because of that, I killed even more people. But the moment I spared someone's life, the moment I, you know, let someone live, it ended up, that's when things changed. You know, he even apologized for, because he's like, the fact is, Ramsey was supposed to die, but because Cole met Cassie, you know, they even said at the beginning of this season, they were like, it changed something in Cole. He was more sympathetic, and he ended up going back and saving Ramsey, and that changed. It led to a lot of change. The fact is, he spared Jennifer, didn't kill her. Things changed even more. He's like, essentially, like, we don't have to kill people. Saving people is what changes things. Killing people doesn't change anything. Because the fact is, Cole feels responsible. He's like, I'm sorry, because I'm the one that made you this way. And Cassie's like, no, I made my own choices. You didn't. The path I'm on right now is because of me. You didn't do that. And you kind of see her a little sad and kind of almost crying near the end, because it's like, she isn't the same person she was. And it's just kind of, I guess on some level, she is a little sad. Because it's like, can there ever really be them anymore? In the past, it seemed like there could be. There was a strong possibility of it. But now, it's like, now that they're... Now that she's changed like this, maybe there's no... I don't know. I think on some level, she, you know, she acts like she's okay with everything, but I think it is starting to weigh on her. She's thinking like, okay, I'm doing the right thing, but it's like, you know, even when we kill people, things don't change, but by sparing people, maybe that's how it changed. I don't know. It's so good. I love that development, that relationship. It's just kind of like they were getting close in the first season, but it seems like they're getting pulled apart because... they aren't the same people that they were before. But I hope on some level Cassie does. There's a part of me that enjoys the conflict, so I want Cassie to kind of stay the way she is. But it's because I kind of want her and Cole together. It's kind of like, oh, but I do want you to go back to the way you were, because you were a very kind person. You're the one that kind of changed Cole. I feel like out of anybody, you being kind is what's going to help change everything. But at the same time, it's kind of like, I kind of wanted him with Jennifer. Jennifer's a little nuts, but it's just like, she's a very sweet person. She was just manipulated and just told that, oh, this is what you're meant to do, nothing else. Can't wait to see more from this series. To see where we, like I said, continue seeing where we're going with this season. So good, it's so good. But that's really all I want to talk about in this episode. Till the next time we meet, be happy, be safe, live life to the fullest, and enjoy it. Good day and... goodbye.